Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Creekside. So great to see you all. Why don't you stand and join us in giving praise to our good and gracious Heavenly Father.
Thank you. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin.
Let's read this prayer together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen.
Cover.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for doing the one thing that we could not do, removing our sin as far as the east is from the west, Lord. Only you can do it, and we love you because of that. And we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, welcome to Creekside. It's so great to have you all here. Parents, take your notes out. There's a very important announcement coming on, and have a seat.
All right, just drop the kids off at church for parents' night out.
Great, spend with you about 3 hours. Where do you want to go?
This is the night. It's a beautiful night, and we call it Bella.
On Saturday, March 4th, from 4 o'clock to 7 o'clock p.m., Creekside will provide free childcare for infants through fifth graders at Parents' Night Out. The kids will enjoy a movie, pizza, and snacks, while parents enjoy 3 hours of free time.
Side by side with your loved one, you'll find enchantment here. The night will leave its magic spell.
Spots are limited, and you must sign up ahead of time. Sign up at creeksidecommunity.org/parentsnightout.
Good morning. I'm John Bruce, one of the pastors here. And if this is your first Sunday with us, we're so glad you're here. We'd like to give you a free gift if you'd like one. We've got a coffee tumbler, a water bottle, or a sippy cup. And you can pick that up at the information desk out here after the service. If any of you have prayer requests or questions about our church, there is a gray card in the seat back in front of you. You can fill out if you have ways you'd like to be of help, or find out about small groups, or how you can serve at Creekside. There's a red card to fill out. Anyway, fill out those and drop them over in the offering slot. The kids can go to their classes, and want the rest of you to stand up and say good morning to the people around you. Let's suppose that you have to drive down to Los Angeles this week. So here's my question, what route will you take? Will you take the scenic route down 101? Or will you take the faster, uglier route down the 5? Or will you take the really scenic route down 1 and hit every little town and restaurant all the way down? It depends on what your goal is. If your goal is to get there as fast as possible, you got to take the 5. If your goal is to enjoy the trip, you'll take 101, or even better, Pacific Coast Highway. The point is, your destination determines your route. The Bible does not give us a command for every situation. Have you noticed that? There are clear commands. It's always wrong to commit adultery. It's always right to trust God. But most of life's decisions fall between the verses. And there's not a specific verse telling you what to do. You've been offered two jobs. Which one should you take? Are you going to drive a Honda, a Toyota, or not even own a car? Are you going to live in the city, or the small town, or out in the country? Some people think that God has a secret will for all those decisions. And our job is to seek him and pray and wait until we hear from him. And other people think, if the Bible doesn't say, you're free to do whatever you want. But Paul gives us a third alternative, and that's what we might call the principle of expediency. That is, you take the most direct route. This morning, as we continue in 1 Corinthians, Paul's going to talk specifically to unmarrieds and whether or not they should get married. He's already said in the earlier part of this chapter that God gives some the gift of marriage and gives others the gift of singleness. But how do you tell which camp you're in? Well, that's what he's going to talk about here. The principle of expediency is not telling the difference between right and wrong. It's the difference between good and better. And I think you'll find this helpful because this principle occurs throughout the rest of 1 Corinthians in different contexts. So we're going to look at what Paul says about how to decide whether to marry or not, but we will apply it to other areas of our lives. So that's where we're going. Let's pray and ask God to lead us today. Thank you, Father, for your word, for the way you use it to make us alive in our spirit. And again, we want to stop and remember that we can't learn a thing unless you teach us. We need you to give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a mind that understands and a heart that believes. And we'll give you the glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul has already told the Corinthians that marriage is God's will for some and singleness is God's will for others. However, we need a little more information for ourselves on how to discern, and this is what this is about. Now, concerning virgins. Remember, part of 1 Corinthians is about problems in the church. The second part is about questions that they have sent to Paul. And this is the second question. We looked at the first one in the earlier part of 1 Corinthians 7. Now this is the second. Now concerning virgins, I have no command of the Lord. Paul has no specific word from Jesus that answers this question, how to know if you should get married or not. But I give an opinion as one who by the mercy of the Lord is trustworthy. Now, you might think that, okay, this is all Paul's opinion. But remember, Paul is an apostle. He says all Scripture is inspired by God. This is the word of God just as much as what Jesus said. So that's why he emphasized trustworthy. This is coming from God. I think, then, that it is good in view of the present distress that it is good for a man to remain as he is, which we've seen in the past in this chapter. Let each person remain in the position he became a Christian in. What is the present distress? Some people think the present distress is the growing antagonism toward Christianity in the Roman Empire. In about 10 years, there will be an official persecution will begin. Already there are riots, and the Jews are already persecuting the Christians. I don't think that's what it is. Because remember, Corinth is written not just to the Corinthians, but it's written to the whole church throughout the ages. And so I think Paul is talking about the condition of the world in this age. Jesus said, this world is passing away and also its lusts. In this world you'll have tribulation, but take courage, I've overcome the world. He's saying, in light of the world in which we live in, which is passing away, which is not going to be here forever, this is why I think you should remain in the condition you're in. Now, what's that mean for marriage? Are you bound to a wife Do not seek to be released. Don't get divorced. Are you released from a wife? Are you divorced? Do not seek a wife. But if you marry, you have not sinned. Jeff showed us a couple of weeks ago how there are certain situations where a divorced Christian can remarry. And if a virgin marries, she has not sinned. Yet such will have trouble in this life, and I'm trying to spare you. Again, the principle of expediency is not good or evil, right or wrong. It's good and better. Complex or simple. Distracted or focused. That's the idea here. Now, how does this apply to believers? But this I say, brethren, that the time has been shortened. This, Paul believed, along with all Christians, that the return of Christ was imminent, that would happen during his lifetime. And he's just pointing out what we've all believed is that this world is coming to an end. It could end today, for all we know. This world is not permanent, and so we should not live as if it's permanent. But we should take into consideration that there is a better world coming and live in light of that. So that from now on, those who have wives should be as those that had none. That married Christians and single Christians should be equally committed to Christ. As those who weep, as though they did not weep. There is sorrow in this world, but the Christian who's focused on the next age realizes that these sorrows are temporary and that unspeakable joy is to come, so we don't take those sorrows as seriously. And those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice. There are things in this world that give us joy, but they're gone very quickly. Your team wins the Super Bowl today, but tomorrow comes and it's the same as the day before, right? So rejoice in those things, but don't get too excited because the joys come and go. Those who buy as though they did not possess. Don't live for what you own because you're a steward. You're a trustee, and you will give an account to Jesus how you use the things you bought. And those who use the world do not make full use of it, for the form of this world is passing away. Paul says, live in this world in light of the fact that this world is very temporary. Its joys are temporary. Its sorrows are temporary. Its trials are temporary, that you're going to a better place. So live, carry the world, this world lightly. Lori and I have been amazed at how God has blessed us. And yet as we get older, we're not focusing on our bodies that are becoming progressively less attractive and our minds that just aren't quite as sharp as they once be. But what we're focusing on is the day soon to come when we'll each stand before Jesus to give an account and to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master. You were faithful with a few things. Now come and be put in charge of much. That's what life is about. So Paul says, live your life in light of the fact that you live in a very temporary world and a very temporary life, and make the most of the life you have. That's the idea here. But I want you to be free from concern. It's so interesting that throughout this passage, Paul is not heaping on the guilt or saying, you need to do this. I want you to be free. I want you to be undistracted. I want you to enjoy the life that you have. And it may be more expedient for some people to say, stay single. One who is unmarried is concerned about the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, how he may please his wife, and his interests are divided. If you're single, you have the potential to being focused totally on God. But if you're married, you must be concerned about pleasing your mate. Things like life insurance policies and medical insurance and taxes and investments and all these things just to be a responsible head of the family. The woman who is unmarried and the virgin is concerned about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit, But one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. Paul is not saying that marriage is bad and singleness is good. Remember, God is the one who created marriage. God is the one who said it is not good that man should live alone. God is the one who appointed the family to bring the next generation. Marriage is good, but marriage may not be good for you. That's what Paul is saying here. It has to do with this: I say for your own benefit, not to put a restraint on you, but to promote what is appropriate and secure undistracted devotion to the Lord. That's kind of the key verse in this whole thing. My goal here is not to put restrictions on you. My goal here is that you be undistracted in your devotion to the Lord, whether it's married or single. That the goal here is to be as undistracted and free to serve the Lord as you can. Jesus told his disciples one day, what God has joined together, let no man separate. And his disciples, he just basically saying that marriage is permanent. Marriage is for life. And his disciples were shocked. And they said, well, if that's the way marriage is, we all ought to stay single. And Jesus had a very interesting comment about that. He said, not all people can accept this. There are some that are gifted to be single. There are some to be gifted to be married. And doing what God has gifted you to do will give you the most undistracted walk with Him. That's the idea here. What's going to get me to my goal most expeditiously? Will I be more undistracted, married or single? John Wesley was one of the great heroes of the Christian faith, founder of Methodism, and had a tremendous ministry as a single man, preached all over England, started a whole movement. But at 48, he made an ill-advised marriage to a widow named Molly Bazile. And when his brother Charles heard about it, he said in 17th century language, oy vey, because he knew his brother. He knew what he was like. And sure enough, there was all these conflicts between Molly and John. Because John was always out preaching. He was always out traveling around. And she felt neglected. Plus, all these letters kept arriving at their house from all these women who were looking for spiritual help. And she read them before he got them. And so she began progressively more angry and jealous, and she began to accuse him of having affairs, and then she began writing letters to various publications about his affairs and just giving all this, causing nothing but problems for him. And he told her to submit and be content. And that worked about as well as you might imagine. A friend of his stopped by their house one day, and he walked in, and he saw Molly dragging John across the floor by his hair. But what she made up for in physical violence, he made up for in verbal violence, and he once wrote to her that if she was dead in the ground or had never been born, it would not have harmed the cause of Christ at all. And finally, this was a man who was not gifted to be married, right? And for him, marriage was a distraction. She finally left him, and he had the one comment in his journal about his marriage. He said, I did not send her away. I will not recall her. And for Lori and I, on the other hand, I have been amazed at how much easier it is to be undistracted in my relationship with God, married to her, than it was when I was single. It was a complete surprise to me. I didn't anticipate that. But she has become my greatest encouragement. She is an encouragement to my walk with Christ every single day, and I think she would say the same thing about me. It is easier to be undistracted in our relationship with God because we have been gifted and called to be married. And that's what Paul's saying here. He's saying, do what gives you the most undistracted walk with Christ. That's the idea. Now let's see how he applies this principle. If any man thinks he is acting unbecomingly toward his virgin daughter, if she is past her youth, and if it must be so, let him do what he wishes. He does not sin. Let her marry. In that culture, women were under the authority of their fathers until they went under the authority of their husbands. And so all marriages were arranged. And so in that culture, Paul says, if your daughter is old enough to make up her own mind, and if she wants to be married, if it must be so, then let her be married. It's fine. But he who stands firm in his own heart, being under no constraint, the word is necessity there, the necessity, know that his daughter does not want to get married, but has authority over his own will and has decided this in his heart to keep his own virgin daughter, he will do well. So he's saying, if your daughter wants to get married, then by all means, let her get married. If your daughter has no desire to be married, don't feel compelled by the culture in which everybody got married that she needs to be married. Let her do what's best for her own relationship with God. So both he who gives his own virgin daughter in marriage does well, and he who does not give her in marriage will do better. Now my question is, why does he say better? Why does he say better there? If marriage is a gift from God and singleness is a gift from God, why does he say better? Well, there's two ways to interpret that. One way is that being single is more spiritual than being married. And that's why our Catholic brothers and sisters have got it right, that they have priests and nuns, and I don't think that's what it means. Because Paul has already said marriage is a good thing. God gifts some to be married, he gifts some to be single. I think what he's saying, in this particular situation, where a father has a daughter who has no interest in being married, he does better by keeping her single than by following society and having her be married. I think that's what it means. Essentially, this is the principle of expediency. Do what gives the less distraction from your relationship with God. That's the idea here. Now Paul addresses those who have been married before. A wife is bound as long as her husband lives. Marriage is for life. But if her husband is dead, she is freed to be married to whom she wishes, only in the Lord. She can get married, but just let her marry a Christian. But in my opinion, she is happier if she remains as she is, and I think that I also have the Spirit of God. Which decision leads more likely to undistracted devotion to God? That's the question. If you've been married, you're not married now, and you want to get married, because Paul already said it's better to marry than to burn with lust. If you have a bunch of young children at home and you need two parents, then by all means get married. But if you're unmarried now and don't need to be married in order to be happy, then stay single, like Paul did. And Paul says, I think she'll be happier that way. See the point? Now, let's move. You see how the principle works. You take the most direct route to your goal. And that helps you making a lot of decisions. See, one of the mistakes we make in making decisions and trying to discern God's will is we focus on one thing rather than everything and how this decision affects my overall walk with God. Let's say you get offered a job in another state and it's going to pay you a lot more money. So from a financial perspective, it's a good idea to take the job. And yet if you make that decision in that way without looking at all the other factors, How's it going to affect my walk with God? Am I leaving my family behind here? Am I leaving my church behind? Am I leaving my non-believing friends that I've been trying to win to Christ behind? You're not looking at the whole picture. And you can end up making not bad choice, but a more complicated choice. Something that will cause more distraction, more difficult in serving God. And so that's the idea here, is that as you make decisions, you want to look at the big picture. I'm living in the last days. I don't know how long I'm going to be here. I want to have the biggest impact for Christ I can. So what should I do to have an undistracted devotion to Christ rather than complicating my life with more things that I'll wish I hadn't done in the past? Does that make sense? I think that one of the clues here, or keys in living with this perspective, is seeing your life through the lens of the story of the Bible. The Bible tells one story, and it's a rescue story. It's a story about how God rescues people and the world from evil and death. And the hero of that story is Jesus, right? So right after Adam and Eve lose everything God has given them through their rebellion to God, God immediately makes a promise that he's going to send a human savior who will fix everything they wrecked and will undo the evil they've done. And throughout the Old Testament, God keeps giving more and more clues to who this savior will be, numbering in the hundreds. So that when Jesus arrives, he fulfills those hundreds of clues and predictions. He lives the life we fail to live so that God can credit everyone who puts their faith in him with his perfect record of righteousness. He is the only human being to ever live a perfect life. And he lives it so that we can receive the benefit of that. He dies the death we deserve to die, bearing the wrath of God for our sins on the cross so that God can forgive everyone who puts their trust in him. And then he rises from the dead as the first new man of a new humanity who will live in a new heaven and a new earth as God restores everything to what he originally created. And if I see my life through that story, it makes a lot of decisions easier. First of all, it says I need to make my first concern to be reconciled to God. Jesus said, "He who comes to me, I will in no way cast out." And if you are not a Christian, if you haven't asked Christ to be your Savior, you're only a prayer away. Say, "Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive my sins. Make me the person you want me to be." And then you realize you're living on this world for a limited amount of time to tell more people about Jesus and to live your life. How can I be the most effective, the most fruitful? That becomes the overriding goal of my life. And that's where living according to the principle of excuse me, what is that principle? Expediency. I knew I was going to do that. Begins to make sense because God doesn't give you what to do in every situation. Yet as you have a clear goal, a clear objective you're going to, making those decisions becomes so much easier because you see how they all fit together. Does that make sense? I want to read this passage one more time because I think it says it all. "But this I say, brethren, the time has been shortened, so that from now on those who have wives should be as those that had none, and those who weep as though they did not weep, and those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice, and those who buy as though they did not possess, and those who use the world as they do not make full use of it. For the form of this world is passing away. Let's pray. Thank you for the eternal life you've given us, Lord. Forgive us for living like this life is all there is and complicating our lives needlessly. I pray that you'll help us to see everything in light of our ultimate goal and to choose accordingly. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand, we'll sing this hymn together. God of peace bless you. Go in peace.